4.5 acres of sovereign and mobile American territory. That's how the US Navy describes their Nimitz-class carrier. Most people know what an aircraft carrier or a submarine is, but there are 7 categories of modern warship, which consists of aircraft carriers, cruisers, destroyers, frigates, corvettes, amphibious assault ships, and submarines.
What about battleships?
Oh, well, a battleship was a large armored warship with large caliber guns. They were the most powerful type of warship during the late 19th and early 20th century. But as newer types of warships started traveling the blue waters, battleships faded away, with the last one being decommissioned at the end of the Cold War.
And how about the other...
No more audience questions during the video. That's what the comments section is for. So once your voyage through this video is over, you'd know why destroyers are called as such, even though all warships have the power to destroy. And you'd finally know what differentiates these classes of ships from one another. Or will you? The first aircraft carriers became operational in the early 1920s, storing, launching, recovering, and servicing aircraft at sea, enabling a nation with airborne operations far away from home and close to the enemy is very advantageous for obvious reasons. A single supercarrier holds enough firepower to rival the entire air forces of some nations. A carrier air wing is able to perform over 150 strike missions at once, hitting over 700 targets a day, but they can also protect friendly forces, conduct electronic warfare, assist in special operations, and carry out search and rescue missions. Supercarriers can accommodate 4,000 to 5,000 personnel, including the ship's company, air wing, and other support staff. Even though aircraft carriers do have surface-to-air missiles, guns, and other armament, they usually do not travel alone. Instead, they travel with a fleet composed of other classes of military ships called the Carrier Strike Group, which is typically made up of an aircraft carrier, at least one cruiser and 2 destroyers or frigates, and a carrier air wing of 65 to 70 aircraft. A carrier strike group could also on occasion include submarines, logistic ships, and a supply ship. An aircraft carrier often acts as the command platform for large battle groups or multinational task forces. Aircraft carriers traditionally ran on diesel fuel, but some of the newer aircraft carriers are nuclear powered. In colonial times, a cruiser would have been cruising the world, showing off their flag and representing the overwhelming force that could be brought to bear far from home. The name has stayed, but the role is not exactly just cruising around anymore. During the period between the end of the First World War in 1918 and the beginning of the Second World War in 1939, also known as the interwar period, cruisers were limited by treaty to a maximum size of 10,000 tons. 2 types were defined by treaty. The heavy cruisers carried anywhere between 8 to 10 8-inch guns, and the light cruisers carried 12 to 15 6-inch guns. But both heavy and light cruisers carried a heavy battery of secondary and anti-aircraft guns. In wartime, cruisers were to operate alone on the high seas to interdict enemy commerce, but also to protect the battle line against enemy light cruisers. These were mostly heavy cruiser roles, but both types of cruisers usually had top speeds in excess of 30 knots. Today's cruisers are primarily guided missile warships, ranging in size anywhere from 7,000 to 10,000 tons. Only the world's largest navies can afford to build and operate modern cruisers, principally the United States and Russia. In today's world, the role of the cruiser depends on the navy that it's employed in. In the US Navy, cruisers are primarily an anti-air defense vessel, while in the Russian Navy, they're anti-ship platforms. Other missions include commerce raidings and shore bombardments. Even though the US Navy at some point had a number of nuclear-powered cruisers in its fleet, they were all decommissioned in the 90s since they were deemed too expensive to build and maintain. Okay, enough cruising, let's move on to destroyers. Before we talk about destroyers, we need to briefly talk about torpedoes. In 1866, an English engineer called Robert Whitehead invented the first effective self-propelled underwater torpedo, eponymously named Whitehead torpedo. At the time, battleships were heavily armored and protected against gunfire, but only above the waterline. So the invention of Whitehead torpedoes changed everything. Suddenly, there was a weapon that could be carried on a small, fast, and relatively inexpensive boat called a torpedo boat that could strike a large ship underwater, bypassing all its armor protection. A torpedo had the potential to cripple and even sink a battleship with one blow. But wait, with all its armament, why wouldn't a large battleship be able to annihilate a little torpedo boat? See, the turbine engine allowed the torpedo boats to reach speeds that challenged the large caliber but slow-firing guns on the battleships and cruisers. As a result, a new class of ships emerged to protect the main fleet from torpedo boats, and it was creatively called torpedo boat destroyers. Torpedo boat destroyers were larger than torpedo boats, but much, much smaller than the cruisers, and this meant that they were more maneuverable and better equipped to deal with the torpedo boats. So they started traveling the blue waters with the fleet to protect them against torpedo boats. But shortly after, the destroyers themselves were armed with torpedoes, which allowed them to torpedo bigger enemy warships beyond the range of the small coastal torpedo boats. And that was the end of it for the torpedo boats. But not for the torpedo boat destroyers, which are now just referred to as destroyers. Destroyers were protectors of the fleet, so when submarines became practical, the destroyers were equipped with depth charges, sonar, and other anti-submarine weapons, and became the submarine's number one enemy. And when the aircraft became a major threat to the naval fleet, destroyers adopted anti-air missiles. So this is how destroyers became the jack of all trades among warships. Today, destroyers are the largest surface combatant operated by most navies, ranging in size up to 6,000 tons. Destroyers were fast ships, generally capable of speeds in excess of 30 knots in calm seas. But with the destroyers getting larger and more heavily armed, the difference between the cruisers and destroyers have greatly diminished. While a cruiser should nominally be bigger, this is not always the case. But a cruiser is generally considered to have greater facilities for command and control, at least in the US Navy, which often means cruisers have more space and spare energy to power the additional communication equipment and a command and control room to coordinate the defense of the fleet. Similar to destroyers, frigates are quite common ships in a Navy's fleet. They're quick to maneuver, and their role is to escort and protect larger vehicles from air, surface, and underwater threats. Frigates are one of the smallest blue water surface combatants. In the past, they used to carry a lighter main battery than destroyers. For example, 3 3-inch or 2 5-inch guns would have been typical. These days, they may have anti-air guns and perhaps a small battery of torpedo tubes. However, they're not particularly well suited to theater air defense. Their strength is usually in their anti-submarine weapons. For example, the Royal Navy's Duke class of frigates have specialized anti-submarine warfare capabilities and are fitted with enhanced sonar equipment and torpedoes. Anti-submarine warfare frigates come with helipads and hangars that accommodate helicopters capable of identifying and attacking nuclear submarines using torpedoes and depth charges. Frigates are traditionally slower than destroyers, although in modern times there's not a significant difference in their speed. Today's frigates often displace up to 3,000 tons and are usually capable of top speeds of 27 to 30 knots. One of the faster frigates is the Indian Navy's Chivalric class, which can travel at speeds of up to 32 knots. Some European navies, such as the Dutch, French, German, and Spanish, use the term frigate for both their destroyers and their frigates. Vessels that are smaller than frigates are typically identified as corvettes or missile boats, which are not big enough to have a full air defense radar, and therefore are not used to escort other vessels or defend large areas. They play more of an offense role, given that they can use their anti-ship missiles to attack and are small and maneuverable enough to avoid being hit. They're also typically not suited or capable of operating in blue waters, so they typically stay closer to the shores. A missile boat is a small craft outfitted with several anti-ship missiles. They have low cost and are somewhat an outgrowth of torpedo boats from World War II. A corvette is a smaller version of a modern frigate, but it's usually geared towards one type of mission, either surface or anti-submarine warfare. The first littoral combat ship, USS Freedom, was commissioned in 2008. Littoral combat ships are a US Navy design, meant to replace the Perry-class frigates. While the LCS-class ships are smaller than the frigate class that they're replacing, they offer a similar level of weaponry while requiring less than 50% of the crew. They can have a top speed that exceeds 40 knots. Littoral combat ships are smaller vessels and are well suited for littoral or close-to-shore operations. In other countries' navies, the closest thing to littoral combat ships would be patrol vessels or corvettes. One interesting feature of littoral combat ships was their modular design. They could be reconfigured for different roles, like anti-submarine warfare or surface warfare, by changing their weapon systems, sensors, and mission crews. These module changes were envisioned to happen within a few hours, but in practice they took a lot longer and proved to be logistically difficult. In a 2016 announcement, the US Navy abandoned the modular concept for littoral combat ships and decided to use them with a single module. Amphibious assault ships are used to help land and support ground forces on enemy territory. At a glance, they resemble aircraft carriers, but they're primarily designed for supporting helicopters. They can also carry vertical and short takeoff and landing aircraft. Most modern amphibious assault ships have a well deck, which is a hangar-like deck located at the waterline in the stern of the ship. When the well deck is flooded, landing craft like hovercraft can be launched and recovered without the need for a crane. A submarine, also commonly referred to as a sub, is a watercraft that's capable of independent underwater operations. Submarines typically fall into one of three propulsion categories: diesel-electric transmission, nuclear power, and air-independent propulsion. All current submarines in the US Navy are nuclear-powered, but there are a few other countries like Russia, France, the UK, China, and India which also have nuclear-powered subs in their fleet. Submarines range in size from midget submarines with a displacement of less than 150 tons to ballistic missile submarines with a displacement of up to 48,000 tons when submerged. And regardless of their size, they're all referred to as boats. There are three major types of submarines in the US Navy: attack submarines, cruise missile submarines, and ballistic missile submarines. Attack submarines use torpedoes as their main armament and have more of a multi-role mission. They're smaller in size, making them faster and more maneuverable. Cruise missile submarines are typically larger and slower boats focused on long-distance strikes using guided missiles. Ballistic missile submarines, as the name suggests, can carry and launch nuclear ballistic missiles. If you take a look at the seven categories of warships that were just reviewed, aircraft carriers, amphibious assault ships, and submarines are quite easily distinguishable from one another, both in appearance and in the role that they play. However, the appearance and roles that cruisers, destroyers, frigates, and corvettes once had have been blurred over time. Most of them now have a mix of anti-surface, anti-submarine, and anti-aircraft weapons, and their size and displacement does not necessarily fall within the traditional class designations. It's kind of like iPhones, iPads, and iPods. They used to look different from one another and do different things, but now they all have cameras, touchscreen, and FaceTime, with the only real differentiating factor being the headphone jack on the iPod.